Hello students, good afternoon. Today I will teach about pneumonia. Pneumonia in simple terms is called as, or it is defined as, the inflammation of lung parenchyma. It is an infectious disease due to bacteria, virus, fungus or mycobacteria. Let us see the classification of pneumonia. Pneumonia is classified into, first, community acquired, which is most common. Second is nosocomial or hospital acquired pneumonia. Third is immunocompromised patients who are suffering from pneumonia, because the organisms which are causing pneumonia in immunocompromised patient is totally different from community acquired pneumonia. And the last group is aspiration pneumonia. Let us see the organisms which are causing pneumonia. The most common is Streptococcus pneumonia, then followed by Haemophilus influenzae, and lastly Mycoplasma pneumonia. It is not so common. Then pneumonia caused by viruses, especially it is seen in children. Hospital acquired pneumonia or nosocomial pneumonia is caused by Pseudomonas, Staphylococcus aureus, Klebsiella. And the immunocompromised patients, pneumonia is caused due to Pneumocystis carinii pneumonia. It is a type of protozoa, fungal pneumonia and tuberculosis pneumonia. Aspiration pneumonia, it is a separate entity. Aspiration of any type of food particles into the respiratory tract can initiate a chemical reaction and will favor the growth of organism like Streptococcus, Staphylococcus, etc. Let us see the pathophysiology of pneumonia. Normally, the upper airway protects potential infectious particles from reaching the lower respiratory tract, but if the organism enters into the lower respiratory tract either through the upper respiratory tract or by blood bond, then the organism will enter into the pulmonary circulation. There it will get trapped inside the pulmonary capillary bed, and then the series of inflammatory process will start. Inflammation will start. That means there will be infiltration of WBCs, neutrophils, and thus in the alveoli it will cause edema. When it causes edema, there will be partial occlusion of bronchi and also alveoli. So the total surface area for gas exchange will be definitely reduced, and eventually there is decreased oxygen saturation in the arterial blood. Also, the inflammation can generate bronchospasm in some of the patients. Let us see now the potential factors or the risk factors for pneumonia. First is elderly population. Second is very young age population. Third is a crowded place. Then patients who are on ventilator because of faulty or poor practices in the hospital, like improperly cleaned equipments, etc. Then patients with AIDS. AIDS is a type of immunocompromised state. Then patients or persons who have chronic alcoholism, persons with chronic alcoholism, because alcohol will also depress the total cough reflex and will cause pneumonia. It is a very important risk factor for the development of pneumonia. Then person with COPD. COPD itself is a respiratory disease and can cause pneumonia. Then diabetes, again it is a type of immunocompromised state, and those persons are at risk for the development of pneumonia. Next factor is the prolonged immobility. Prolonged immobility will again depress the cough reflex. It will promote more retention of secretions and more growth of microorganisms, so the person can develop pneumonia. let us see the clinical features of pneumonia. As it is an infectious disease, the patients will experience fever. So there is rapidly rising fever. It is around 38.5 to 40.5 degrees Celsius. Fever is associated with chills. Then the patient have pleuritic chest pain. That means on inspiration, the person will experience more pain. Then there will be tachypnea, shortness of breath, or dyspnea. Use of accessory muscles in respiration, especially seen in children. Then the person will have tachycardia. In some patients, there will be upper respiratory tract infection before pneumonia, which will progress into low-grade fever, myalgia, and pleuritic pain. In patients with pneumonia, there will be production of lot of sputum. The sputum is mucopurulent. The color is rusty, blood-tinged. Evaluation is done by, or diagnostic assessment is done by doing a chest examination. In chest examination, there will be total dullness over the lung parenchyma. That is, there will be no vesicular breath sounds. Only bronchial breath sounds are heard. Then a complete blood count can be done. In that, there will be increased amount of WBCs. Blood culture is done to find out the exact causative organism of pneumonia. Chest X-ray will find out the changes in the lung. Then sputum test is also done to find out the cause of pneumonia. Pulse oximetry is done to find out the oxygen saturation, which is reduced in case of pneumonia. Then come to the treatment of the pneumonia. The pharmacological drugs or the treatment are, first is azithromycin, erythromycin, clarithromycin. Then the second one is any type of fluoroquinolones can be given to the patient. Then third, beta-lactam antibiotics can be given to the patient. Examples are ceftriaxone, cefuroxime, etc. Then in case of resistance, linezolid, vancomycin can be used for the patients. The supportive treatment of pneumonia includes bed rest. Patient is encouraged for bed rest. It will improve the general condition of the patient. Then lot of fluid is also encouraged for the patient because there is loss of insensible water due to tachypnea. Then fever management should be done by using antipyretics, cold sponging, etc. Then if the person has lot of cough which is not productive, then antitussives can be given. It will reduce the cough production. And if arterial oxygen saturation is low, then supplemental oxygen therapy should be given to maintain the arterial oxygen saturation in the blood. Coming to the nursing management, the responsibility of the nurse is, first we have to see that the airway is clear. How to do the airway clearance? There are various methods in that. We can do chest physiotherapy, we can do frequent suctioning, encourage fluid to the patients, high humidity oxygen therapy can be given to liquefy secretions, and thus the airway can be made clear. Then second is monitoring of complications. Complications are like atelectasis, pleural effusion. The person can go into respiratory failure. So these should be monitored and also to be prevented. Third is adequate bed rest. The patient is encouraged for bed rest because it will improve the condition of the patient. The patient can take rest in a semi-Fowler's position, which is comfortable for breathing. Then next is maintaining the fluid volume balance. Because the person experiences tachypnea, there is more water loss, and so the fluid volume balance should be maintained by encouraging the patient to take water frequently, at least 2 liters per day. After that, nutrition management is done by giving the persons lot of fluids. In that fluids, glucose can be added, electrolytes can be added, because in early phase appetite is lost. So fluids rich in glucose and electrolytes can be given to maintain the nutrition. Slowly and gradually, the more solids can be added in the diet, and high protein diet is normally recommended. Last is providing knowledge. Knowledge means how to prevent the pneumonia from recurring, and knowledge related to the hygiene practices, etc., to be given to the patient. So this is all about pneumonia. You should do a detailed book reading with a standard textbook, and also the nursing management should be written. If you are writing the nursing management by making nursing diagnosis, then it will be much better, and try to write and memorize those points. This will help you to write a better answer in the examination. Thank you, students.